Here we are here again. D-man put it in. We got it back. Second man quick. Our F3 holds the middle of the ice. Second guy's in quicker than they are. Here we are here again. Second man quick, right here, we got the puck, now we skate. Anytime we get the puck out of traffic, we skate. Skate again, look. Now, there's our Nesson game. Use the back of the net, use the width, activate the defenseman, right to the net. Here we are here, north, east, west. Activate defenseman, see how we hold our shooter. Here we are here. So here's what Nesson looks like. North. East. South. North. That's how you create space and tire people out.
It's almost like basketball where they go around with.
Here you are here. There's your north, there's your south, there's your east, there you go. Okay, so watch how consistent our shooter stays. Now sometimes there's an interchange of position, but there's always a fallback plan to the shooter. See how we hold? Now, there's our shooter. Defenseman's being active, but our shooter stays and holds his position. Right there, see that? When you play with man in the middle, it's hard to be aggressive against us. See how we play man in the middle hockey? Hold the middle of the ice. Now we get a second guy in. Now Berge's going to become the shooter. He backs up this play here. There he is. Now look at Osh reads it. Look, he's the shooter.
Popped up from the corner.
Can we turn the light on? So that's kind of a synopsis of our 5-on-5 game. Any questions?
What's the difficulty between two teams who play the same system and try to counter those systems? What are they tweaking here and there during their on, like during in-game switches and stuff like that? How are they breaking that system down?
Well, a lot of it comes down to puck support and effort. A lot of it comes down to difference of determination and not determination. You know, like Detroit and us pretty well use the same system, same terminology, and they didn't come with much determination the first couple of games we played. We drilled them, and then they really picked it up later on, so their games were great. There's probably three or four teams that play a different style, but everybody else pretty much plays this style. It's the demands you place on your player. I can tell you right now, you can tell the teams that are going to win in three areas. Number one is, how hard do their forwards work for their defensemen? That's number one. Number two is, how good are both ends of their special teams? And number three is how good their goaltending is. If you have good goaltending and your special teams, especially your penalty killing, is really good, and your forwards are willing to back check for your defenseman, then that's winning hockey.
What was the last one, sorry, Cam?
How hard your forwards work for your defense.
And the special teams and the difference,
right? And then the goalie.
Yeah, you had a great goal.
We can't win. Your goalie has to be 9-10 or better, save percentage, and your special teams have to be 105 or better. Your two numbers have to be 105 or better for it to work. And preferably, if you're going to have a shitty power play, you've got to have great penalty killing. Your penalty killing allows you to be aggressive and play with risk. You can play nasty, you can play with physical risk, but your penalty killing has to, you have to be able, you trust that you can kill a penalty from a guy being a little bit too aggressive. Playing over the top.
So what about for the Olympics? Are you going to have to change a lot, or?
I think for us, for the Olympics, a lot of it's going to be based on adjustment by personnel, because everybody has to play different. Everybody has to do something different. Scores have to check. You have to play 200 feet. If you can't play 200 feet, you just can't play in the Olympics. You know, like, Mike's not going to have any patience for anybody that's not committed to 200 feet. And, you know, there's going to be some good players left out because of that. You know, if he watches you play and he doesn't trust that you've got that mindset, then he just isn't going to put you on the team. No matter how many points you have, no matter what your skill set is, if he doesn't see that commitment. Because we all understand when you put the crest on, everybody plays A+. And yes, Canada has great players and we've got depth, but if you look at 25 players to choose your team from, you can only build one team. Everybody in that A pool has got 25 good players. So it's going to take a lot for us to win. We know that. Any other questions? Ray, any thoughts from you?
It's good. Think about skating tomorrow morning.
Yeah. Pretty exciting stuff. That help you a little bit? Get a better understanding of how you win and what wins and...
Well, and, you certainly appreciate you doing this. That's for sure.
Well, I was telling people today, I just feel like you guys are helping us. I mean, the hockey school is one thing, but this is a hockey school. I mean, we've all taught these. They're important, but they're hockey schools. And you guys gotta come out of this thing with something more than 6 or 7 new drills. We appreciate what you're doing for the community and for the culture and everything. But at the end of the day, you gotta gain something from it. So we felt like we wanted to put this on for you, and hopefully you get some good information moving forward that help you understand what it's like to play in our league and what winning programs have. Winning programs have exactly the same stuff. Boston and Chicago, they're no different than the top 4 or 5 teams. There's a little edge they had. They won, yes, but they don't do it any different than, I would say, the top 8 teams at the end of the day. They all play the same way, and they all play with the same commitment. And those things that I show you, those are the commitments you gotta have. And I'm telling you, they are really difficult to get. Really hard to get your players to do this stuff. Not easy. And, or else everybody can do it. But they are very difficult, especially forwards working their defensemen, the competitive level you need to have to score goals, all those things are very difficult to impact in your team, get your team to play that way.
So is the new Oiler head coach, is he going to try to do it similar to what you guys are going to do? Or?
I don't know as a game philosophy, because I didn't watch his team that closely. They play with effort, though. He's going to have a, you know, he's a demanding guy. I think, you know, they've added mature guys, NHL coaches to the staff, but, you know, they got a lot of skill and a lot of talent, and we'll see, but it's easy to talk about this stuff. It's awful difficult to do it. Very difficult to do it.
One of the things that, and you can't answer, you know the answer, is, because you saw my presentation. So when Hitch was going through our team system, and he had forecheck up, and he had D-zone, he had neutral zone, particularly forecheck and neutral zone, do you remember what labels he had applied to our forecheck and neutral zone? Like, in other words, 1-2-2 or 2-1-2, or what did he have up there?
Lock and slide.
1-2-2 lock, 1-2-2 slide. Yeah.
Lock the middle.
Lock, right?
Do you remember the answer?
No.
There are no laces.
There are no laces.
Well, you hunt Jim. The first guy that chipped still has to hunt.
Right, but there's no. There's so, no, in other words, when you talk to your team, or you talk to your team, you talk to your team, you're teaching a 1-2-2, you're teaching a 2-1-2, you're teaching a neutral zone 1-3, or you've got a label that you apply. And I didn't notice it, Hitch, until I started to prepare for that presentation. And when I went through it, there isn't, I mean, we play a 2-1-2 if we can with aggression, and he talked about that. When's the right time for that F2 or F3, depending on how you want to label it, to go or not go, in which case you would say we're probably more of a 1-2-2, right? So on a wheel, we only want to use one guy. So we're only using a 1-2-2 there, theoretically, like if you want to apply labels and so on. But the bigger point is all the detail that he's included in there is absolutely relevant and pertinent to being successful in checking and playing defense and or offensively. If you want to give a label to how you play in your offensive zone, as we do with Nesson, it's not the label of Nesson, it's the application of the tactics and the skills that are required. We can't play the way we want to play if we don't check properly, if we don't check with our stick on the ice, and we don't take away the next best thing, and if we don't angle properly and understand all of that, we have nothing. We have guys getting caught out of position because they don't understand angling and reads. And so when you talk to your players and you say take away the next best passing lane, you have to spend time making sure they understand what that means. Like, how do they do that? You have to drill them on that. And so when he talks about our transition practices, it's all that. They have to do it in order to be successful, because it's not like if we start diesel and coverage, as he suggested, if you don't check, you don't get out. You don't get a chance to go to the other end and finish on transition playing offense. So it's really important that you apply, you know, in thinking about that, and when you're working with younger coaches or even your players, is that don't get lost in the labels and all of those things. Make sure you go to the detail and make sure you drill it and that you apply it and coach it and teach it and reinforce it, because that's how you'll get a strong 1-2-2 or 2-1-2 or whatever, however you want to approach it.
Yeah. To me, I get a kick out of a guy says, well, we want to play fast. Well, I just start laughing. Like, okay, you tell me how you want to play fast. Well, we want to do this. We want to skate with the puck. And I just start laughing. When a team's supposed to play, turn that off, you know. And the history with Ray, and Ray and I, this is year 3. We've been together with St. Louis. Ray's responsibility with the Blues is he does pregame preparation, postgame review. So, and Ray is the eye in the sky that brings information directly to me on a game-by-game, period-by-period basis. So any in-game adjustments is worked out between Ray and myself. So he brings the information and says these are the things we need to do. This is the tactic that needs to get changed. And then the next day, Ray has a responsibility for reviewing every aspect of our offensive play, from breakouts to counters to attacks to offensive zone play to scoring chances for it. And he analyzes all that. And we have one coach that does it offensively. That's Ray. And another coach who does it defensively, that's Brad Shaw. So we break the game down in that type of detail.
All right, as Hitch said, this is a presentation I've done a couple times to different groups, and I'll tell you too that it's the impetus for me, the groups, two groups, where one was at the NHL Coaches Association meetings at the draft, rather the seminar at the draft, and the other was to Hockey Alberta's HP1. And the background for it, for me, is in part with what we do in with our team, but really the impetus for me was more, by background, I have a 17-year-old boy who's playing in Youngstown in the USHL. I have a 16-year-old daughter who played hockey up until just a few years ago and now is a softball player, and I have a 11-year-old boy who plays hockey. So I have a 17-year-old that's really quite a good player and I think has a very good chance at playing university hockey or college hockey in the States. I have a daughter who's a very good softball player, but unfortunately social activities, including her friends in the mall, have sort of taken her off track a little bit. But then my 11-year-old is an absolute meatball. Like, he loves the game, and I'll just show you. This was his first goal ever after about 2 years of house league hockey. So just happened that a guy was there taking pictures, and that's his first goal ever. But he's a meatball. He loves the game, hates to practice, and isn't the kid that's gonna go downstairs and shoot 100 pucks a night like his brother would have, or even his sister would have if she was hitting softballs or something like that. But what it does, though, is it took me to a point in my thinking about where we're at, because when you talk to coaches in these symposium situations, I probably will disappoint you to some degree today, because you may be looking for our team and tactical play. Here is what we do in our systems. And that was where I started to design this presentation, and then I stopped myself, because what I found was, and what I thought was, and what I believe is, that unless we as coaches, not just you, and not just the coach of my 11-year-old, or my 17-year-old, or us with the Blues, or the guys that are out there working with this group of kids, or you with your kids, unless we teach skills and get them to have a really good understanding of how to apply those skills in tactical situations, think about this. Is there any system that you could put in that they will succeed at? Right? And so we all know that, I think. That's not news to anybody in here. But what it is it forces us to have a very real sense of what we have to do as coaches to give our players a better chance to succeed. Now, here is really, in a thumbnail way, exactly what we're up against. And I hope, you didn't have to plug in speakers? Okay. We'll see if we can get this loud enough. Let me see if this will work. Where'd it go? There it is. Okay. Oh, come on.
How did your game go last night? We won. But I didn't even get in the game.
That's okay. You are only a sophomore and you are playing on varsity. So on. My coach sucks. Your coach has been coaching for 15 years, has won 3 state championships, and 5 conference titles. Your team is 17-3 this season. So on. My coach sucks. How can you say that? Because my dad, my girlfriend, and my AAU coach all tell me how good I am, and that I should play more. I'm telling you, my coach sucks. They just say that because they love you. They don't know basketball. My coach sucks. Have you talked with your coach and asked what you can do to earn more playing time? No, my coach sucks. Do you come in before practice to work on your game? No, my coach sucks. Do you practice as hard as you can all of the time? No, my coach sucks. Did you work hard during the off season? Did you lift weights? Run sprints? Work on your ball handling and shooting? No, my coach sucks. You need to stop blaming your coach and hold yourself accountable. But my coach sucks. If you want to be the best player you can be, then your coach is the only person you should listen to. You suck.
So that's
what we battle, right? Sorry, Carly, I used to have it as hockey, but Carly's background is a basketball player at the University of Alberta for a long time, but I had to change it to basketball to protect the integrity of hockey, I'm sorry. Because that never happened, right? But anyway, that's a little funny about something that we've all seen. I'm going to zip through some of this. I've got, there's a little bit, I admit to this being a little bit academic at some points, and I'm going to try to get through into more of where we're at with our team and talking about, you know, the real points of emphasis here, but as well as some video stuff that really highlights is tremendous video and should show you exactly where we're at with a lot of our stuff. The knocks on defensive play, we hear it all the time. So if you watch the NHL playoffs or you watch games regularly, or really any level of play that happens to be televised, or if you read newspapers and so on, Damian Cox in the Toronto Sun, I think he writes for, bashed the NHL playoffs through the whole course of the spring, saying, you know, weren't those 1-0 games or those 2-1 games just lovely, you know, sarcastically speaking. So playing solid defense and learning to play that way is not easy. It's a hard thing to convince your players to do. People outside of the game rail against it all the time. They don't like it. They don't feel there's any real value in it, that, you know, going back to the 9-8 score was really the way it should go. And so we have to fight that. And there has to be justification for what we do as coaches. And really, and Hitch talks about this all the time, is that the reason why we and other teams can be good offensive teams is you have to play good defense to get the puck back. And once you get it, then you have an opportunity to play offense, which makes sense to everybody. But they need to have, so we say that, and we have an understanding of what that means, except that we have to arm our players with the skills necessary to do that, to get pucks back, to limit the time that we spend in our defensive zone, to limit the time that we have without the puck so that we get the puck and we can go the other way and do the things that are all fun for everybody, which is playing with the puck and scoring goals. So that's what we have to do. And if we just say that offense is really the most important and that defense is the genesis, then let's really challenge ourselves to think about what that next level means and how do we get there. In practice planning, for example, we spend an awful lot of time, and probably more time, with offensive situations, flow drills, shooting drills, etc. We have to make sure that there's a creative balance in our practices and our thinking and our philosophies so that we balance one against the other. And Hitch talks all the time, and I'm sorry if I'm stealing any of your thunder here as we go, but he talks all the time about our practices. And what we do in our practices is, if you start in a defensive situation, so defensive zone coverage is an example, you're never going to end there. You're always going to end on offense, and vice versa. If you start in an offensive zone situation, you're never going to end there. You're going to end in defensive zone coverage. So there's a transition. There's a give and take, exactly the way the game is played. So to try and create that balance within your team so you can make all those points of emphasis that you need to make is important. And you need to do that, and you have to have a conscience to it as a coach and how you plan. How do you avoid this restrictive coaching tag? So we understand our business very well. You know, the wins you need to keep and stay employed, et cetera, et cetera. The unfortunate part about youth sports now, and it's rampant not only in Canada, but the US certainly, and in every sport, not just hockey, is that as a volunteer coach or a coach of youth hockey, you're at risk too. We see it all the time. And so you do what you have to do to try to win games so that you can keep coaching kids, which is so unfortunate. But the other thing that comes along is part of what we have to do to win games is know we have to play good defense, but then you get tagged, you get labeled, right? So guys that have coached in the league for a long time, who are tremendously successful in the NHL especially, get labeled. This guy is a great defensive coach, Jacques Martin. If I say that name to you, what sticks in your head right now? Great defensive guy, right? When Pittsburgh just hired him as an assistant, what was included in every sportscaster's comments? He was what? Why was he hired? Did anybody see that? Sorry? Right, their defensive team play, right? So he's got that label. Apparently he's okay with it. It's got him back into the league for the time being. But those labels exist and they get stuck on you. So Hitch talks about chances all the time. And taking chances in our end to create turnovers, be aggressive with our play. When you watch our team play, and other good teams for sure, and it's not just us, but to speak to us specifically, we are as aggressive as we can be within, you know, making good percentage, high percentage decisions. Be as aggressive as you can be. Why? Because we want to limit the amount of time that we spend on our own end. So let's go after teams, put them under pressure. If they make a brilliant play, fair enough, good on them. But let's put them under pressure so that we can get the puck back, create loose pucks, and get going. We need really good support, so when you see some of the defensive clips of video, what you'll see with us is five guys on the same side of the puck. We outnumber teams around the puck, and we create loose pucks and get going the other way as quick as we can. We have a 70-30 rule that Hitch talks about. We want to try to play 70% on offense, 30% of every shift on defense. Okay? So, hard to create offense, so we require more discipline with the puck, and we have to value it. So, everybody's playing good defense now. I'm talking to you about it. You understand it. We talked about the reasons for it, to try to win games, et cetera, et cetera. So everybody's playing good defense. Then when you get the puck on offense, you have to create a sense of pride and value in your players so that when they get it, they want to keep it. And not only do you have to create the soul, the mental part of that, that encourages them to do that, but you have to also arm them then with the offensive skills to do that. The skating skills, the cutback ability, to set an edge and drive away from a defender that's set on you, right? Or if you have players or a player or a group of players on your team who skate very hunched over and they get into contact situations, all somebody does is put a little pressure on their back and down they go. So you have to correct some of those things. So you have to give your players the physical tools and the mental tools then to have success and encourage them to get the soul of understanding to value the puck. So again, what he talks about, what we talk about with our team all the time is, when we get in the offensive zone and we get the puck and we keep it and we cycle or skate when we cycle the puck, we don't just stand still and allow teams to get us into a corner and then take the puck away. We have to skate and we encourage that, but we ask them to make the play they want to make when it's the right play. So don't make a play, you know, you're under trouble, you're on me, you're right on my butt, I know it. I'm in thinking, geez, I'm going to panic. I'm anxious about you having there all the things that players go through. So I'm just going to throw it somewhere else and make it somebody else's problem. We don't accept that. And it's easy to say, but you can get it out of your players if you demand it. Why did you just throw the puck away there? What were you doing with the puck? Why didn't you value it enough to keep it, to use those skating skills that we worked with you on, those puck skills that we're working with you on, to cut back, make another cut back, get your head up, make a pass, make a play to somebody. Right, so now you're not hearing me talk about this negative defensive team play. You're hearing me reinforce what we want to do offensively, which is all part and parcel because we were playing that 70-30 philosophy or better then. So once we possess it, we want to hold on to it. In general, just a couple things here to talk about. Protecting the middle of the ice. And I think, again, if you think about where you've been in your coaching careers or playing careers or talked about hockey or wherever you're at, I grew up with George Kingston's view of the hockey rink. If you put it up this way, and the idea that we protected the middle of the ice right from here down through the dot line, back out through here, up and in. So the idea was that you protected that. That's where all the dangerous scoring chances tend to come from, right? So that's our general philosophy on defense. Okay, would we all agree with that? That would seem to make sense. However, to play solid defensive play, you have to be prepared to get aggressive outside the dots when it's the right thing to do, to take away time and space. Why? Why do you need to take away time and space from good players? Because they make plays. So squish that time and space, eliminate with aggressive play that makes sense, and get outside the dots. Don't just stand inside. You have to get outside and play hard. You have to be able to create or check, and then you've got to be able to create transition. So a whole bunch of things going into play there. So at no point have we talked about our system yet. We've just talked about philosophy and how we want to get there. But at the same time, hopefully you're starting to get the picture that, again, without talking about any structure or defensive team play structure, we are setting in place the need for us to develop the skills and the understanding for all of these kids to play that way, to play in our structure, to play our players, to play well. They have to be encouraged to get outside the dots and play aggressively when it's the right thing to do. So the guys that are taught properly, just the last point there, to play that way, they should be confident to go outside, to be aggressive in those areas, to feel like they can go after good players and limit their time and space, and then go from there. These are just things, I'm going to zip through these, I'm not going to spend very much time at all here, but these are all, if you've spent any time in Hockey Alberta or Hockey Canada's coaching program, you'll recognize these terms. Pressure, the idea of taking away time and space, which you spoke to. Contain install, so if you're in a defensive situation where it's a 2-on-1, 3-on-2, you're outnumbered, one of the tactics you have to use and be and get your players to understand is that they don't, you know, when they're outnumbered, they have a chance to be aggressive, they should, but more than that, all they need to do is stall the attack until they get help, right? And then once that happens, then we can get right back into our aggressive play. And that leads right into, you know, if you think about defensive play, that takes you in the context of team play, 5-on-5, should also take you to special teams too, right? So your penalty kill falls right into that thinking. Support, which is something that you need to talk about all the time. It's probably the most critical component when you talk about philosophy and principles in the game. Creating layers to your net, so if one guy gets beat, there's another player there to support him while we recover. And then transition finally. The ability to go, when you're on the attack, get into a really strong defensive posture. And again, the term that we use, we're on the attack, we turn it over, 5 hard strides. Gets us back into thinking where we can get 5 in the picture quickly, meaning good numbers, and we get everybody pushed to one side of the ice where we really outnumber somebody, and we work that way to get our transition game going. Because a good offense to defense transition with everybody buying into that idea that 5 hard strides gets us back should then get us into a position where we turn pucks over, and what do we do then? We're back into that 70-30 where we're creating offense, okay? Again, all the same stuff that you probably are aware of, but things that you need to keep revisiting in your planning and as you go through your season with your players. Don't just touch on skating, balance, awareness, angling skills, checking skills, puck skills in the first week with your team and then forget about them thinking it's all in place and ready to go. You have to continue to revisit those. They should be part and parcel of every day that you get on the ice, and it should be reinforced with everything that you do in terms of your drills. The other thing I'll mention too, guys, is that I'd be more than happy to, rather than I see guys scurrying here and I'm flipping through these slides, is that I don't know how we'll manage this, but we'll get it done somehow where I will give this presentation, maybe to you, Carly, and then we'll dump that little video out because it makes it too big, but then you can maybe, if you leave your email address for Carly, she could email it to you. So that way I'll get you the information so you don't have to scramble to write it down quite so quick. So then we get to player development. So before you can expect execution and performance in any skill or tactical area, then what you need to be doing is thinking this way. It's practice, practice, practice. And repetition is the thing that, you know, this is straight out of any kinesiology or physiology or degree program where you start to learn on growth and development and skill acquisition and so on, is that there's a tremendous number of repetitions that are required in a physical skill for you to start to gain some level of competence. Your ability to perform it under pressure or in certain situations, you need to repeat, repeat, repeat. And that's the type of thing that whether for coaches, the challenge is sometimes we feel like we're doing the same drill over again. You know, the players get bored of it or whatever. That's okay, we need to find a way then to change that drill a little bit, knowing that skill set or the skills that are required in that little drill that we're doing, whatever that is, has to be repeated over and over again. And not just repeated, but corrected and taught properly and given good feedback to it so we get a change and a growth in what they're doing. There's a great book out there if you're interested in it. It's not an easy read, it takes some time, but the idea that talent is overrated. Okay, so we all hear at different times people speak to the idea that Tiger Woods, Wayne Gretzky, whomever, pick the Manning boys, et cetera, any sport, any time, God-given talent, or that it is gifted to them naturally in some way. But this Talent is Overrated book really challenges you to think in a different way, thinking that it's not necessarily, like there might be some genetics involved in some situations, there might be some physiology that gets passed from one generation to another in a certain family, but the idea through this book is that it's not natural, and I think we can conclude that with people like Gretzky in our sport. Gretzky's story is well known. What is it? What are some of the elements of Gretzky's story as he grows up?
Love of the game.
Love of the game, but where does that start? very early on through his dad. Through his dad in his backyard. Right? And what happened on his backyard?
Played every day.
He was out there every from the time that that backyard rink was frozen, he was out there playing. And the other most important point is, yes, he's out there playing and he's out there doing whatever, but what's another element of that story?
He's got some drills his dad set
yes.
up for him.
His dad would go out and work with him. So Tiger Woods, shift sports. What's Tiger's story? Quickly, anybody? Dad coached him when? Like really young, right? Do you remember, did you ever see the video clip of Tiger Woods on, was it Johnny Carson or something? So he's like 2.5 years old with his little golf club coming out there and drilling it, right? But anyway, that's his dad cut his golf club off for him, went to work with him in the backyard. And some would tell you probably, if you dug deep enough and read the stuff, is that his dad probably wasn't real nice to him at times, right? As a 2.5 or 3-year-old kid, probably put him in some tough situations and demanded an awful lot out of him. But the point is, and I'm not suggesting that for a second, that's not the point. The point is that you have to commit to teach and give your highest value to practice, right? That's how you'll create talent. So again, we struggle with that all the time when we talk about, you know, ice costs, et cetera, but practice is really the way to do it. And this book, this Talent is Overrated book, really speaks to this idea, this deliberate practice idea. So it's you know, again, I'm not going to get bogged down in the academics of what this presents, but it's getting them to do something that's clearly defined, a task, okay? And it's appropriate for whatever level they're playing or working at. Could be skill. In this book, they make lots of examples out of chess players as an example, not just athletes, but they certainly spend time on Woods and so on. Then provide very clear, concise, appropriate feedback. So this, and I've got in brackets there, skill development for a coach, because as coaches, we have to be better at providing feedback. Rather than just saying, good job, we need to tell you what you did in that good job. What was appropriate in that activity, so you understand clearly what was good, not just good job. Praise is fine at times. Praise as praise is good, right? Couldn't argue that. But we need to make sure it's very concise and appropriate, and the feedback is exactly what it needs to be. Then you now need to allow players, this goes back to that repetition idea, let them repeat. Let them do it over and over and over again. Allow for error correction. Get them to do it properly. Get them to refine it. So there's no better example than what we just went through here. We had a boy out there the first day, and I think you saw a little bit of the skating stuff we did at the beginning, that edge work stuff. Very simple stuff, right? Very simple. We had a number of boys out there that could not do the first four exercises, forwards and backwards, couldn't do it, couldn't complete a turn on an outside edge and get around. So with his encouragement, what we've done is every day, every A session, we started the same way, the same drills, and did them and gave them feedback and talked to them and let them do it over and over again. And so now to the point where every boy in that group does it not just good, great. Okay? So that has very little to do with us, other than giving them the opportunity to repeat it and do it, and then just give them some feedback. The real credit goes to the athlete who has the courage to stay with it, to accept our instruction and our guidance, stay with it, and correct themselves. So now every guy out there does it. And now we're to the point where they're doing it and they're not just doing it and doing it well, they're doing it great. So that when they get into game situations, it's good for them, they understand it. They get in and that 1 foot inside leg, outside edge, turn, that's not happening at that speed anytime in their game, not happen. But what you're teaching them to do is to get on that outside edge, ride, and get comfortable, because in a game, sometime that's gonna happen, whether they're on an outside edge or an inside edge, and they gotta get off it, onto the other edge, onto their leg, or they're twisted around this way, and they're set on that back foot, so rather than just crumpling because they aren't comfortable anymore, that they're able to get on that outside edge, pivot, turn around, and get themselves set to go. That's what we're trying to do. It's not that little turn, but it's getting on those edges and getting them comfortable there. So we repeated it, and now no better example than what we've done here with this group of kids. The theory is that with training somewhere in the 50 hours, that you get them to the point that they perform the skill consistently without really thinking. They just go and do it. So at that point now, so we've all seen this, and we all get our players, and we see growth and development in them, and we say, okay, good, well then we'll move on to another area. But it's important that you stay at least in that area for a little while longer and stretch them, take them to a point maybe where they'll fail again, back it off, and then challenge them again. Take them. Keep taking them a little bit further so that the back end was here. Take them out, get them good there, and then bring that back end forward and take it out again. Right? That would be the idea. So then our challenge as coaches is to continually redesign practices and push them, stretch them, which is what we just talked about. So we get to another point here, and we've all seen this type of situation before. So dad's spending some time with his kid out on the field, got them all set up. Like, look at the stance, really. I mean, pretty good, right? So this is a little weak kid. Could maybe open up the feet a little bit more, but really good, pretty good hand position. Got the bat up where it needs to be. We could probably spread these out a little bit more. He's at a good distance, and he's throwing overhand. He's not lobbing it, right? So watch what happens. This is, again, where we're at sometimes with our coaching. So even though we do all of that good work, see what happens? Right there. That's not Sasquatch in the background. That's his sister going out to pick up the balls at the back, and that he decides that's way more fun than what I'm doing. That's the way it goes. So that attention span, we're challenged by that too. All right, so here's our team play. Defensive team play, forecheck, track and reload, neutral zone forecheck, and D-zone coverage. This is kind of where we're at. So this is, for the most part, exactly what we will put up on September 12th when our players come for training camp. They'll check in on the 11th, they'll do their medicals, etc. On September 12th, they will begin to see this, exactly, word for word. This is what our forecheck looks like. So when we're teaching our players, and it'll be supported by dialogue, a description of this, and then video support. So they'll see this. Okay, so forward, same sip, side chip, two on the puck. I'm not going to spend a ton of time talking about that, but same side chip, I mean the emphasis, points of emphasis here. Sticks take away the next pass, F1 to pursue, create separation. On wheel, only one chases, so when the defenseman on the opposite team picks up the puck here, wheels the net, we don't want to lose two people in here at the back here. We would like, if we have to, we'll lose one, but then we'll hold positions out here. That's what that means. Okay, so only one chases. Pressure D to D, so now we've gone with one player here. If they're wheeling and we're going to chase one, if they're over here and they're looking to make an overplay, we're going to pressure that pass. So if it goes D to D by them, we're looking to jump that, right? So we're pressure here, they go here, we're going. We want to create pressure, create turnovers, and create offense, right? They wheel behind the net, they got good possession, we'll risk one guy, but we're not going to risk two, okay? So that's kind of what that means. Take away the next pass. So that was for our forwards. For our defensemen, here's just a few teaching cues as well, ideas that we'll give to them. Our D will pinch on a second pass on the boards, either D to D or reverse. So we really want our defensemen to be active and participating in our defense, right? Because forecheck is defensive play. We want them to be active and participating so that they can be part of a five-man group that's pressuring to create loose pucks and then offense after that. So D-man pinch, a second pass on the board. So what we're talking about there is if you get into a situation where so they've gone over D to D, we've likely pressured here, we're going to pressure there. If we don't turn the puck over, if we're late or they make a good play by us, that our D are pressuring and pinching on that play. So that's a second pass. One pass, two pass, let's go. Okay, so that's our second pass. Our D are active. Our F3 is in a real good high position there so that when this D pinches, he's able to support. Okay, so that's what that means.
And so Ray, you're saying here on the reverse, so they reverse bump and end up having your D pinched down on the strong side?
Yeah. Well, typically, so in a typical reverse situation, so you would have a D-man pick up a puck somewhere here, wheeling behind the net, D-partner calls for the reverse, and he comes back up here. So this is one pass, this is two pass. That's our D is also going to pinch that. Okay, so it's based on two pass pinch. Strong puck side gap, and then punch the puck back down. So when we pinch, we want to get the puck, 100%. Okay, that is our goal. And if we can't control the puck, then what we have to do is make sure we do our very best to push the puck back down into the zone so that we can get our numbers back on it and create the forecheck and get the puck turned over. Okay, so again, I'm zipping through this here. Okay. And I just want to make a point. I'm going to go back here. This is going to feel like you're at the eye doctor when he puts up the slides. Come on. There we go. So there it is. So there's our forwards. Just a quick review for you. There's our D-man. Okay, and then we're going to talk about this. This is really a defining element for our team. But before I do that and go back, I want you to think about what was our forecheck? Was it a 1-2-2? Was it a 2-1-2? What did it say up there?
Nothing.
Nothing.
To read.
To read and react pretty much.
Right, exactly. Right, so think about that. We all do it, and there's real good reason for it to give a label.